Hi guys, welcome to another episode on Troubles Restoration. In this episode, we're going to be stripping her dash. How many tools do you think I'm going to need to strip a 356 dash? Let me know in the comments. I'm going to be counting. Let's go.
Today, my job is to take the dash out. I'm going to be taking all of the dials, the instruments, all of the different switches and whatnot. Fortunately, someone's made my job a little bit easier, as you can see here. There is a hole where my clock used to be. Someone's already removed the clock. And there's another hole over here. There's another hole here, which for some time has always confused me. So I wasn't entirely sure why I had another hole here. And my original thought was that when they cut the dash out to put this 8-track in, the kind of lip on the clock was too big to sit in here, so it could no longer fit, so that they then cut a new hole here. But my research has found that cars were also spec'd with inside outside temperature gauges, so you could also have an additional dial which was an inside outside temperature gauge. And when that was fitted, Porsche recommended that what you did is cut another 62 millimeter hole like this on the right hand side of the glove box here, and then take the clock and put it in here, and then put your new inside outside temperature gauge in here. So that is why I have two holes in my dashboard. Spaghetti junction. This does not look good. Well, what I'm going to start with is, this is a 12 volt 8-track, so I'm going to start by removing the 6 to 12 volt converter and the 8-track, because that will get rid of, I believe, most of this spaghetti junction. And then I'm going to be working on the slightly more simple, sounds really simple, switches and dials. So yeah, let's go.
Okay, so now we are under my dash. Here we have my 6 volt to 12 volt converter, which is just strapped on under my glove box. This has a series of wires coming out. These then go into this. Good fun. Some of these are labeled, which might be helpful. So we have speaker common. Oh, that actually says left speaker. This says right speaker. So this is all part of the sound system cabling. I'm going to remove this first.
Oh, your geckos are hatching.
My geckos.
So I started by tidying up these wires so that I could see the wood through the trees. All of these were attached to my 6 to 12 volt converter. Fortunately, all I had to use was my fingers, so no tools needed at the moment. It's clear that back in 1962, cable ties or cable tidies, whatever they're really called, weren't a thing. This was an absolute mess. You might be wondering why Trouble has this 6 to 12 volt converter. The reason is because her electrical system is actually 6 volts and her 8-track required a 12 volt supply. So what this converter does is it takes the 6 volts and it basically amplifies it to 12 volts. It's similar to like a little water pump, but instead of you putting water into it, you're putting electricity in. And instead of you increasing the pressure of the water, you're just increasing the voltage. As you can see, it was secured really well. It was fixed in place with this electrical tape and then one screw. So yeah, my first tool, a Phillips screwdriver. With the converter out, I could then start work on taking the 8-track out. To do this, I had to use another tool. This second tool may or may not just be my favourite tool we have in our toolbox.
See how big my spanner is? Massive.
So this spanner is a BA spanner, and its purpose is to undo BA fastenings and fixings. I'm not actually sure if these little screws were BA fixings, but there's a good chance they were, as BA fixings were often used on electrical equipment. But yeah, the reason why I used it is because it was the only spanner that we had that I could find to fit these tiny little screws. What these screws were doing were holding in the faceplate of the 8-track, and there were two at the top and there were two at the bottom. Once I'd undone all four little screws, I was then able to take the faceplate off, which then allowed me to take the main body of the 8-track out from under the dash. So I've successfully now removed two items off the dash, the converter and the 8-track, and I've used two tools. We're 2 for 2.
If anyone wants an 8-track, let me know. I've got one for sale.
With both the converter and the 8-track out, I could now get much better access to my window wiper switch and the cigar lighter. So I started with the window wiper switch, and guess what? Third item on my dash, and we had to use a third tool. So this tool isn't necessarily a conventional tool, it's actually a scribe, and the reason why I used it was to stop my window wiper switch from rotating. So this switch is actually, it has a variable resistor in it, so you pull it out to turn the window wipers on, and then you rotate it to change the speed. I needed to unscrew the knob on the switch, and when I tried to unscrew it, all it did was turn the resistor. So I had to find a way to stop the resistor from turning, and the way I did that is by putting the scribe through a hole that was through the switch shaft, and then I could stop it from rotating and then undo the knob. Once I'd taken off the knob, I was then able to undo the clamping nut that was holding the switch into the dash. With the clamping nut off, I could remove the switch, and then all I had to do was remove the wires. These wires were connected to the switch with bullet connectors. It's a type of electrical connector. You can kind of imagine it as like a plug and socket for a wire. All I had to do to remove the wires from the switch is just pull the bullet out of the female socket. Let's have a look if I need to use a tool to do this. In theory, I should just be able to pull them out.
Just got this one stubborn...
So that one is a bit persistent.
I did eventually manage to get it out, and without using any tools. With the windscreen wiper off, I then started on the cigarette lighter. Welcome to the stage, tool number 4. I used the spanner to undo the clamping nut that was holding the cigarette lighter to the dash. Although it was a little bit awkward to get to, this nut came undone pretty easily. And actually, so did the bullet connector. This just fell out the back when I tried to take it out.
One cigarette lighter, retaining bracket, on there, the nut was on the back, just tighten that up, and then your, goes in here.
My next target are the heater controls, they're coming off. I started by taking off this lock washer that was holding on the bottom heater cable. This cable is a type of Bowden cable. What a Bowden cable does, it's just kind of like a fancy name for a cable that allows you to transmit a force around a corner. You may have noticed that I'm using another tool to get this lock washer off. Tool number 5, a very small screwdriver. With the bottom heater cable off, I then started taking the switch housing off the dash, thinking that this would allow me to get better access to the cables that attach to the top of the switch housing. So, to do this, I needed another tool. Tool number 5, a very small spanner. Although, once the nuts were loose, it was actually much easier just to spin them off with my fingers. With the heater switch housing loose on the dash, I thought I'd just be able to pull it forward to get to the other heater cables. But the heater cables had other plans for me. They were actually retaining the switch housing, stopping me from pulling it forward. I needed to undo this cable clamp first. I did this, or more accurately, attempted to do this with another small spanner. This spanner was actually a different size to the one I used previously, so here's tool number 6.
I think I may have a nut on the back of this. Yes, I do. No, I don't. Oh, no, I do. Fuck it, I don't know. Can we see a nut on the back of that? Oh, I don't think so. Is there a nut on it? Is there? Oh, there must be a sodding nut on it. There's not a nut on it. Oh my lord, there must be. Oh, I can't see. No, there isn't. It isn't.
What I did find out was there actually is a nut on the top of the bolt. It's a square nut, and I can't properly see, but I think it's supposed to be retained by the wire. I'm not sure. I can't get a spanner on top of it. But what I'm doing is I've got a screwdriver, and I'm putting it between the cable and the square nut. And it's taking up the room to stop the nut from rotating.
The screwdriver I used is again a different size to the one I'd used previously to take off the locking washer. So here's tool number 7. I'm emptying the toolbox pretty quickly.
My square nut's fallen off, which is fantastic. That's on the floor here. So that's the square nut I was talking about.
I didn't make my life particularly easy here. In hindsight, I should have just undone the heater cables from their controls on the other end of the cable, which would have allowed me just to pull the heater switch housing out of the dash with the cables attached. Hindsight is a wonderful thing, and this is definitely how I'm going to be putting the heater control back in.
Again, there's a cable on this adjuster there. You see the cable? It's got a small spring clip on it. Oh. No, it doesn't. It did have a cable on it, but it snapped. Okay, so here we have the heater mechanism. There was a cable on the top of this one up here. Snapped, fantastic. There is a set of cables that go on the bottom one down here. One of those was snapped, which is also fantastic. And then I have my 3 spade connectors that, I believe these are basically variable resistors. So the more, so that's least resistance because the connection is very close. And then as you increase the amount of a track, I guess you could call that a track, as you increase the amount of track between this connection and that connection, the resistance increases. And then likewise, on the back side, there's another one. So up here is where the connection is, which is up here. So that would be maximum resistance, I think. This might be a load of I don't know. I lost my dad. And then moving it that way is reducing the amount of track, so reducing the resistance, I believe. We'll see.
Okay. So I don't know if you just heard that, but we've got... What have we got, Mummy? Got a part of that I've just taken out and apparently not labelled. Anyway, I know where it all goes, so that's fine.
You won't in a year's time.
So the next thing I'm removing is the speedo, because they can't do me for speeding if I haven't got one. That's my...
Is that true? I don't think that's...
No, think not that true.
Whether I can or can't get done for speeding without a speedo is up for debate. But anyway, the speedo is pretty simple. It's mechanically driven with a Bowden cable coming from the left front wheel, and it has 2 backing lights. In theory, all I need to do is undo the cable drive, unplug the spade connectors on the light bulbs, and then undo the two nailed thumb nuts, and it should come off. I definitely shouldn't need a tool to undo the thumb nuts, and the rest of it should just undo by hand. The speedo drive came undone pretty easily, and so did this spade connector. But the other light bulb, well, that was ruining all my plans to get this speedo out without using any tools. I just couldn't get the spade connector off the light bulb. In the end, I resorted to using a pair of pliers to hold the light bulb while I pulled the spade connector off it. I didn't want to use any tools, but here we have tool number 8, a pair of long nose pliers. With the last light bulb off, I could now just undo these thumb screws to take off the retaining clip, and then, again in theory, just take the speedo out of the dash.
In theory, I should just be able to push this through the dash.
There's a rubber washer here that's might have perished.
And I can't. Okay.
As my mum said, there was a rubber washer behind the speedo bezel and the dash. This had perished and was gluing the speedo to the dash, so what I did was get a scraper in between the two to free it off. So that's tool number 8, a scraper. Considering I shouldn't have needed any tools to get this out of the dash, I think I've done well adding 2 more tools to the tally.
There we go.
so that's why I was struggling to just push it out from the dash. That's worked quite nicely. So here is my speedo.
That's a wrap on part one on stripping Trouble's dash. In this episode, we learned two things. The first thing is that it takes 10 tools to strip half a Porsche 356 dash. And the second thing we learned is that I can't count. Follow along next week to watch part two.